This is Business Weekend with Ross Greenwood.
Hi there and welcome to Business Weekend. I'm Ross Greenwood. It's great to have your company. Coming up on the program today, what forced Richard White to walk away from the company he set up 30 years ago when it's quite clear he had unfinished business there? Does this show the danger of a founder CEO whose presence is too linked with the business and when there's no successor in sight?
Once again, why all boards and management teams should be thinking about what happens if.
Jeff Wilson has run Wilson Asset Management, now with $6 billion under management, for 25 years. He famously fought the Labor Party over its plans to change dividend imputation. Now he's worried the government will come after your super next.
If we can be one voice on the side of sanity, then we're very happy to be that.
And the tightness of the US election you can feel is already spooking investors who wonder if interest rates will actually fall as far as they're predicted. It's already pushed gold to record prices. We speak with the senior economics advisor to the US Study Centre, John Kunkel.
In terms of issues, President Trump has an advantage on the economy, I think it's fair to say.
And Ed Boyd investigates, why are Melbourne home prices now cheaper than most other capital cities? So all that and plenty more coming up on today's program. The resignation this week of WiseTech CEO Richard White after a series of allegations from women about his private life highlights the increased moral risk that companies, executive and boards have to face. That White, 69, was effectively forced out as CEO of the company he founded in the 1990s, and considering that he owns 34% of the shares, well, it's quite remarkable. While there are investigations ongoing by the company and by regulators, nobody has alleged any criminal misbehaviour. So why did he dramatically quit this week? No doubt the aim is to quieten the ongoing publicity around his relationships with several women. He will continue as a consultant to the company and the board on his same $1 million-a-year salary for 10 years. With more than a third of the shares, he has skin in the WiseTech game, but others will be left to lift the governance of the ASX-listed company. WiseTech's CargoWise software is now used by the top 25 freight forwarding companies in the world. As he told us, in just August this year, ongoing acquisitions have got the company closer to providing freight companies with a single software program to move goods in and out of warehouses, through ports, shipping customs, then to distribution centres on the other side of the world. And from this clip, you'll understand that the job was not yet complete for Richard White. Retirement or stepping down were not on his radar.
The great thing about it is there's still lots of problems to solve. Even though we've solved a lot of problems, there's still lots of things that don't work right. And in particular, we talked about container transport optimization in this result. And what we're doing there is we're solving a really big problem that everybody's been trying to solve for 20 years, but they've been trying to solve it by using force, by saying pushing harder on the truck driver, harder on the port, whatever it is. And that doesn't work.
But the issue for White shareholders who own 66% of WiseTech shares is the succession plan, or lack thereof. Though age is no barrier, 69, you'd have to say, is at the end of the spectrum for most CEOs. The average age for a new ASX-listed company CEO has been put at 47. Those who stay longer tend to be self-made, like Richard White. So White at 69 is one of those. Jerry Harvey, executive chairman of Harvey Norman, is 85 and showing no signs of retirement. David Dicker from Dicker Data is 70. Sam Hupert at Pro Medicus is 69. Then there are others who are self-made who continue to rule from the position of chair. 79-year-old Solomon Liu at Premier Investments, 84-year-old Kerry Stokes at Seven Group, and 93-year-old Emeritus Chair of News Corporation, Rupert Murdoch. In all these cases, at some stage, the question of succession has to be asked by the broader shareholder base. It's a business risk not to consider the future as a chief executive ages, even if these driven individuals do have a habit of lasting longer than the average. It's all a matter of governance and planning. So let's bring in here Megan Motto, the chief executive of the Governance Institute. Megan, good to have you on the program. I just want to go to this whole issue about succession planning when you've got a very strong individual who also owns a lot of the company.
Indeed, and succession planning is one of the key jobs of any board, is to think about not only the succession planning of the key executive management staff, the CEO and executive beyond, but also the board itself. You know, thinking about when tenures are coming up, the skill set, the mix of the board, what's required for the future. It should be tied to strategy, but it should be a standalone job in its own right. So every, whether it's called a risk and management committee or a people committee of the board, they should be having the conversations around what is the tenure of our staff look like, what is the age profile of our staff look like, and what internal succession planning are we doing to bring the next tier of leaders through the business.
Okay, so that makes absolute common sense to me, except for one thing. If you've got a strong and powerful leader who has built that company, who owns a majority of the shares or is in a controlling shareholding position, they can simply say to you, we're not doing any of that. I'm running the show. I'll run it until they carry me out of here in a box. What do you do under those circumstances?
Look, the question there is about risk management. It's all very well and good for someone to think that they're absolutely indispensable, but unfortunately, life has other plans for us at times. And any board, any CEO, in fact, should be thinking about, well, what happens if I get hit by a bus? What happens if something happens to me where I need to step away from the business?
That's just smart risk management. Precisely what's happened here at WiseTech. If you go back to when the results were announced, when we made that grab and we last spoke to Richard White, he would have had no cognizance that this type of situation could force him out of the company that he founded. And quite clearly, the company had no succession planning going on because it's now having to do a global search for a new chief executive. And the person they've put in as the interim chief executive is the CFO, who already was planning to retire.
Indeed, and that's once again why all boards and management teams should be thinking about what happens if. Because oftentimes succession is, a retirement or resignation can happen because of internal factors to do with the individual, and sometimes it's external factors that can be affecting that. So the question is, are the boards having the conversation? Is the board really thinking through the what if scenario? That is all about what risk management is.
Okay, so then there's also the shareholders. Now, in the case of WiseTech, 66% of the shares are held by others. Now, there's certainly a decent wedge of the company that's owned by White and others who are beholden to White. So in that case, they could have simply said in this situation, I don't think I've done anything wrong. I think this is all a private matter and I think you can all get stuffed. I'm staying. Now, under those circumstances, external shareholders start to bring pressure to the situation.
There's a huge amount of pressure that's brought by external shareholders now from boards all over the country. Shareholder activism and shareholders really holding boards and executives to account, particularly over these perceived all real cultural issues within organisations and the accountabilities around executive behaviour. They're something that the shareholder community is very, very seriously looking at, and coming up to AGM season, all boards are very cognizant of that.
So we don't know what happened internally. We don't know what other investigations might reveal into the future. But in this particular case, if these were private matters of private behaviour, at what point do they start to affect the company? Because I'm sitting here going, yes, you might question judgment, but you can't question that this necessarily affected the operations of the company. So again, why is a person such as Richard White suddenly walking away from that job?
Well, I think there's two issues here. The first is the challenges that we've discussed before about the challenges around a founding CEO, a really charismatic, often leadership character in an organisation, and the challenges around holding that person to account, but also the challenges that that person experiences in running a private company that translates then to a public company. The level of accountability, the level of transparency, there is a real gear change when you run that IPO and become a publicly listed company. You are now accountable to others rather than just being accountable to yourself. So that private personal division with the company is much more blurred under those circumstances. The second real issue here is culture in the organisation. And we always say that culture eats strategy for breakfast. Well, gee whiz, here's a point blank case example of where culture has become really, really important. The perception perception here of misconduct is oftentimes as strong an indicator of any wrongdoing itself. And the board will be asking, well, how are these allegations coming about? What is that saying about the culture of this organisation? What is it saying about what's been allowed to happen under our watch? So the cultural piece becomes very important, particularly with the respect at work legislation and the impact and the increasing responsibility for boards to be thinking about respect at work and the culture in their organisation.
And certainly the big increase in the share price on Friday said something about the investors feeling as though there was a way forward for this company as well. Megan Motto, good to chat to you. Many thanks for your time.
Good to talk.
For 25 years, the one-time stockbroker Jeff Wilson has run Wilson Asset Management. Now, in that time, he's become one of the most outspoken and influential investors in this country. Just a disclaimer here, I was on the original board of Wilson Asset Management when it started out. Wilson's various funds now have around $6 billion in assets under management. But in the past 25 years, he's been a constant campaigner for investors. His most famous was in 2019, resisting the Labor Party's idea to change dividend imputation on shares and to strip away tax credits for many low-income and low-tax investors. I caught up with Jeff Wilson this week to talk with him about the current rumblings to change the tax effectiveness of superannuation. I just started by asking why he actually takes these causes on in the first place anyway.
I suppose if you take a step all the way back, the logic of setting up Wilson Asset Management was to put the little money that I had then with other people's money and to make a difference for them and make a difference in terms of performance. But as we've sort of moved up Maslow's hierarchy of needs in terms of the business become larger, we've been able to stand up for our shareholders. Now, we've got 130,000 shareholders throughout our 8 listed investment companies. So we just think it's very important to, you know, make a difference on behalf of our investors, make a difference on behalf of our employees, but also make a difference on behalf of our shareholders and the retail investor, which unfortunately, you know, people talk about the big end of town. And they see that as institutions. The man in the street or the mum and dad investor, which are have supported us over these 25-odd years, you know, we want to stand up for them. And back in 2018, 2019, like, that was brutal. To me, the corporate world is like, the boxing Queensbury rules where, it's all above the belt, where the political world, if you get involved in that, to me, it's cage fighting. And hey, I'll never go into politics.
Well, hang on. Can I ask you then a question now? You've gone big into social media right now.
Or big.
So you're in the cage. You're fighting tooth and nail.
Yes.
Why have you done that? I've gone out of it. I've got out of it. You've got into it. Why have you got into it?
That's right. You're always fast and I was always slow. it's just, you know, we've got 130,000 shareholders. We've got 85,000 people we email on a weekly basis, and 50% of them open the emails. So we've got a strong group, and probably 60 to 70% of them are self-managed super investors. The logic, I was in the US earlier this year, caught up with Bill Ackman.
One of the famous investors, of the world's famous investors, and one of the very best investors.
That's right. And he was the one who said, why don't you tweet? And pretty much, I'd done very little on Twitter before that. Yeah, I think he's got 1.4 million followers on Twitter. And I said, how much time do you spend? He said, look, not much time at all. And then I met a few other players over there, a few activists. Mm. And I realised that if you want a strong voice, that traditional media is important, but also social media is important as well.
OK, is it important now to campaign in this way against what you see are potential changes that could come? Changes to superannuation, a tax on self-managed superannuation fund. You can see even it's almost building up that superannuation should not be used for intergenerational wealth exchange. You can see these conversations happening in our community right now.
Yeah, and to me the disappointing part is from what the government's doing is you've got Paul Keating, who has effectively created the dividend imputation system, created the superannuation system as we know it now. Some of the policy suggestions that the current government are making, like he's he's strongly against them. And to me, it's, you know, if we can be one voice, on the side of, you know, sanity, then we're very happy to be that. What I think with sort of woke and everyone's trying to keep their head down, and people, I think less people are prepared to take a stand. And, you know, we don't have anyone, like, we're not reporting to anyone. Yeah, we are. We're reporting to our investors, you know, the 130,000 of the mum and dad investors. So it's important for us to stand
up. So tell me another thing. I mean, say, for example, apart from, you've obviously done very well out of this, right? So
we're personally, 100%.
Right, so $6 billion under management. You personally have become very wealthy off the back of it.
Yes.
But the fact that along the way, you've also created things like the Future Generations Fund, where other fund managers come and donate their time. You donate your time to run that particular fund. The money goes to charity. $75 million has gone to charity over a period of time. You've always been big into Matthew Tell, but there's been other charitable things that I know about that you've done. Why, when we live in a world when lots of people are out just for themselves, why have you bothered to take the time to do that?
I'm sure you'd do exactly the same. Yeah, in terms of it comes down to your personal values. One of six kids, and father a doctor, mother a nurse, always the logic was to be involved in your community, and what we've tried to do is to do that, as an organisation, to give back, to make a difference, like financial service has been very rewarding for myself, everyone who I work with, and for our shareholders, in terms of, we've created a lot of wealth for them.
Okay, so the one thing about this is, though, you have small investors in these funds, and you might say they're better or not so well equipped. As you know, there's been a lot of money which has gone to index funds, to tracker funds.
Yeah.
They simply follow the index up, down, sideways. A lot of money is attracted to that.
Yeah.
And a lot of people say the art of funds management is dead. It's too hard to beat the index. It's too hard to suddenly pick a tech stock that flies suddenly, or to pick gold stocks that suddenly are going to go nuts because you want to be a value investor. Is it hard to be an active investment manager these days and to beat the odds?
I think it's always been hard, to be a successful investor. And if it's 25 years ago, is it harder now than it was 25 years ago? To an extent, I might even say it's easier with all that, all effectively the dumb money, the index money, the passive money, because it creates more opportunities, for the active investor. If you're prepared to take a medium long-term view, because you can be you can be wrong from in the short term, but eventually you are right. So to me, the more the passive money there is, the more opportunities will present themselves for the active investor.
Okay, so can you explain something to me at the moment? Australia's economy is dead flat. Interest rates aren't coming down anytime soon, though they are overseas.
Yeah.
Our stock market is at or is close to a record high right now.
Yes.
OK, so somebody's expecting something to happen that isn't here right now. Is the market overvalued, or has the market actually basically got it right and something's going to happen?
I used to believe, in probably 20 or 30 years ago, that it was all about market timing. It was very important. And all the studies you see, if you looked at the last 20 years, if you were not invested in the market, I think in the US, for the best day each year, so it's 20 days you missed out on being invested in the market for the last 20 years, instead of getting about an 8% market performance, which is done, you get zero. Mm. So to me, it's time in the market, which is, which is very important.
I'll tell you, Jeff Wilson, 25 years, we'll do it again in another 25 years, no doubt. Just like Warren Buffett or someone like that, I guess.
Let's hope, Ross.
Jeff Wilson, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Coming up after the break, why Melbourne home prices are lagging so far behind other capital city prices, plus the US election and the impact it's having on the markets.
Thanks for being with us here on Business Weekend. We'll look at the data, and it's patently clear that Melbourne and Victoria are struggling. Melbourne's property prices haven't matched any other capital city since the pandemic. Median home prices there have fallen almost 5% since their peak back in March 2022. And that's 31 months ago. Now, one reason is that buyers in Melbourne have more choice. More apartments were built, and the cash-strapped Victorian government jacked up property taxes on investors and second home buyers, forcing some of them to sell. The median property price there is now $792,000, lower than Sydney, Brisbane and Canberra. Adelaide and Perth are expected to overtake it in the next year or so. So what happened? Ed Boyd investigates.
Melbourne is one of the most desirable places in Australia to live. It's got sport, art, culture, fashion, music and lots of trendy neighbourhoods. And from a first home buyer perspective, it's great value. The median priced home in Melbourne is just $792,000. When compared to other parts of the country, that's an absolute steal. In Sydney, the median price is $1.1 million, Brisbane's $855,000 and in Canberra, it's $839,000. Part of the reason is property listings. There are simply a lot more in Melbourne.
Compared with last year, we've got about 16% more listings, more total listings on the market in Melbourne. Across the country, it's more like 6% more than a year ago. So there's more availability, and that's obviously giving buyers more choice, and that's putting downward pressure on prices.
The other factor keeping prices low is the higher land taxes, which are forcing some property investors to sell up and either move interstate or shift their money into other asset classes.
Melbourne's got a lot of debt sort of problems coming through, and from an investor's point of view, there's been some real challenges around land tax and also some of the minimum standards and requirements that have been introduced to make it very difficult to run your small private rental accommodation business.
The construction of apartments in Melbourne began surging in the late 2000s, far outstripping the other state capitals. Building activity has now slowed sharply in Victoria, but the large increase in development over the past two decades has helped put a lid on prices.
Melbourne has seen kind of flat to lower prices. Sydney's been seeing prices grow. And I think part of that, you know, part of the reason that the smaller capitals have been outperforming is relative affordability. But the reason that Melbourne's done worse than Sydney has been because there's just more homes for people to choose from.
We found the closest house to the Sydney CBD that's being advertised at the median price.
Value is a funny thing. Here in Leichhardt, 4 kilometres west of the Sydney CBD, this home, semi-detached, one bed, one bath, is being price-guided at $1.1 million. But you look across the rest of the country, a similar place in Melbourne could be up to $300,000 less.
The Leichhardt property has been recently painted and presents well for buyers. There are two living areas and a tiny shed in the backyard.
We're going to have pretty fair interest. We actually recently just sold a property just on the other side of this home here at 67 Catherine Street. We have pretty good interest there. It's quite a similar floor plan.
The whole property sits on just 108 square metres, which agent Daniil says is perfect for first home buyers.
Look, I would say probably 85% predominantly are going to be first home buyers, you know. The other 20% is probably going to be your investors and mix of groups of buyers.
First home buyers are also keen on this property in Collingwood. It's the closest home we could find to the Melbourne CBD that falls within the median price. The agent, Andrew, has this house guided between $770,000 and $820,000. And for that, you get two bedrooms, two bathrooms and a small courtyard.
Yeah, I think it's at a very attractive price point, particularly for the area. It's quite under the median value for Collingwood and indeed the inner north. So it is a very good entry point into the area. And I think people expect when they come in to see a little bit of work that's needed.
The house needs a lot of work, but at the first property inspection, 20 groups turned up.
The good thing about our market is that Collingwood and Fitzroy, Carlton, Carlton North, Fitzroy North, Clifton Hill, they're always popular. They're so close to the city, close to parks, lifestyle strips, Smith Street, Brunswick Street, Gertrude Street, and importantly, unis and hospitals.
Homes like this one are being sold by property investors in Victoria who may have held them for decades and feel like now is the right time to move them on.
They're voting with their feet or their wallets, really. We're seeing a lot of investors in Melbourne tapping out of that market. Now, whether they're going interstate or actually looking at other investment alternatives for their money, that's ultimately what the challenge is right now for Victoria.
The Allen government knows this is an issue and just this week announced plans to slash stamp duty for off-the-plan apartments, units and townhouses for the next 12 months. These discounts should make the market more attractive for investors, but the bigger problem is low building approvals numbers, which will crimp housing supply in the future.
Now, the concern is that while there have been lots of homes built in Melbourne, housing approvals have dropped off quite sharply over the past year or so. So there may not be that pipeline to continue that. And that signals that perhaps both the relative affordability of Melbourne as well as slower housing construction in the future will mean higher price growth.
You can kind of feel that the US election right now is tight. You can see it in the candidates and their pitches. You can feel it in the financial markets with big swings in bonds and equities. Now, the outcome, whichever way it goes, has significant consequence for global trade and for Australia's relationship with its most important allies. So think defence, our relations with China, energy policy. Each outcome is different depending on whether Kamala Harris or Donald Trump prevail. Dr. John Kunkel is the Senior Economics Advisor at the US Study Centre. Amongst other roles, he was the Chief of Staff to Prime Minister Scott Morrison and a speechwriter for Prime Minister John Howard. I spoke with him a short time ago.
I think we also need to take account that some of particularly President Trump's proposals, he talks to a degree about putting things like 60% tariffs on China and 10% or 20% tariffs on everyone. But to some extent, I wouldn't say discount them, but I think we need to sort of temper that and just see what happens. I mean, there are really two views under a Trump presidency. One is that it will be more like Trump Mark I, where there are checks and balances, and another view that some of those guardrails won't be there. And the honest answer is we don't know yet. And as you said, the race is still very tight. But you're right to point to things like taxes, trade and energy as all being areas of quite marked difference between the two candidates.
The one thing that really gets me right now is you can see that Trump is attracting supporters who would traditionally be very much left-wing supporters. Union members, it really is about the jobs, the employment prospects, and also the prospects for business development, which is really kind of almost counterintuitive to the way we'd normally look at the black and white of conservative versus liberal politics.
Look, there's a deep realignment sort of been going on in the US political system over a couple of decades now, where sort of high-income, highly educated people have drifted into the Democratic camp, and people who haven't got college degrees and more the working class have voted Republican. And that's, and you know, Donald Trump's been incredibly successful in tapping some of that sentiment, whatever you think about it. So it's also the case that at least prior to COVID, people see a period of real economic strength under President Trump, low inflation. Obviously, inflation is a critical lead in the saddlebags that President Biden had, and to some extent, Vice President Harris is also carrying, because you know prices have gone up anywhere up to 30%, and consumers remember that. So in terms of issues, President Trump has an advantage on the economy, I think it's fair to say.
So then take me to other issues that are going to be important for Australia. I mean, the trade one is vital, and Australia paying potentially more in the future for its defence is also going to be important to Trump. He's made that very clear in the past. So then Australia's own budget is going to be increasingly constrained. We've got deficits out for the next decade, according to the budget, and probably even getting worse now. So where does Australia necessarily find the money to actually try and be more self-sufficient in the future?
Well, look, it's important to point out that under AUKUS, for example, we are already investing quite a lot in defence, including in the US defence industrial base. So there is a story to tell there, and I think what that underlines is we need very active diplomacy, whatever happens, and I'm sure under Kevin Rudd we will have that, and we've been working overtime with both camps. But we do have a positive story to tell about defence spending. Now, you're right that President Trump or potentially any American administration, frankly, is looking for allies and partners to step up more. That's both in national security, but it's also in what increasingly gets talked about as economic security. And that brings in issues around tariffs and export controls and investment screening which have all been part of this new toolkit, in part relating to China, but also just relating to a desire for greater self-sufficiency in the United States.
Because this goes to the heart of the manufacturing of computer chips. It goes to the heart of critical minerals. Some of these key areas where Australia does have some unique propositions, if we start to manufacture some of these things, to push back against China, which you sense in particular in Trump, but even Kamala Harris, is going to be strategically important to them.
Look, I think that's right. I think China policy will actually be largely continuous in the sense that President Biden, I mean, it really started under President Trump, but President Biden put in place a very systematic set of policies around things like semiconductor export control. So none of that, you know, that's all heading in essentially one direction. Now, Australia has a sort of delicate, again, diplomatic road to go there. We've got China as our major trading partner. But I think you mentioned critical minerals. I think that's really important that we have a sort of forward-leaning, positive proposal, whatever happens at the election, about how we can strengthen that era of cooperation. You know, one of the things about this new world order, if you like, technology competition really sits at the heart of it. So in a way, I think Australia needs to work out its technology offering in the alliance. And that's, you know, we're seeing that to some extent with AUKUS Pillar 2, where some of our areas like AI and quantum, we do have a contribution to make. But, you know, we'll need all arms of national power to help manage this next phase.
And so you would have noticed this week the bond market starting to jitter, the concerns about what happens in the future post this election, and really you get a sense that maybe even investors and markets are becoming defensive ahead of this election. That also becomes important because Australia right now seems to be out of whack with the United States and the rest of the world in terms of interest rate movements and even the fight against inflation.
Look, that's true. I think there's the immediacy. I think there's always a period in the run-up, immediately running up to elections, where investors will get jittery and perhaps sit on the sidelines. So I don't think we want to overinterpret that in the next 2 weeks. There is, at the same time, a question mark around US fiscal sustainability, and that's starting to creep in a way that really we haven't seen in our lifetimes. And again, both candidates will have got very expansive policies, Trump in particular on tax, but you know, nobody's really talking about reining in the national debt in the US. That's now 100% of GDP, and in fact that will go up whatever the outcome. So issues of fiscal sustainability, we have them in Australia, and notwithstanding the US is the reserve currency, we're starting to see those issues appear in investor sentiment more than we have in the past.
Dr. John Kunkel from the US Study Centre, many thanks for your time today. Great to chat to you.
Thanks, Ross. Much appreciated.
After the break, Australia's leading advocate on social services, the CEO of ACOS, Cassandra Goldie, on why unemployment benefits need to rise as more people are likely to hit the dole queues in the year ahead. Plus, the naivety of many company directors when it comes to future cyber attacks. It is great to have your company here on Business Weekend. Without Australia's strong ongoing employment market, there's little doubt many families would have fallen through the gaps. The rising cost of living, rents and mortgage costs are almost impossible to support without paid work. Right now, 14.5 million people have a job. More than 620,000 are officially registered as unemployed. But if unemployment does rise, as predicted by the government, then between 150,000 and 200,000 more people could find themselves on the dole queues within the next 18 months. The big question is whether Australia's social security system is deliberately letting people fall between the cracks of our society and what system would better serve the community. Well, Cassandra Goldie is the chief executive of the Australian Council of Social Service, and I spoke with her earlier this week.
Many people seem to want to forget what happened in COVID. It was horrendous. How many people, hundreds of thousands of people losing their jobs overnight. What we're dealing with now is some recovery, but we've still got about 100,000 people who've become unemployed since rates were being ratcheted up. That is exactly what interest rate rises are designed to do. You know, we need to be clear about this. The RBA, it increases the rates so that unemployment goes up and we contract to reduce demand in the economy.
They would argue on
and
the
that court. Is at the expense
yes.
of people who are unemployed. Now, I know the Reserve Bank is trying to balance these two.
Because they would argue that inflation ultimately causes even greater harm in the community and that more people ultimately lose their jobs.
Well, we need to work on both, don't we? So we definitely need to work on inflation. No question for people on low incomes. It's horrendous when the rents go up, your food goes up and the energy bills go up. But at the same time, what's the worst thing that could happen is you lose your job.
That's right.
And then you're back on this woefully inadequate unemployment payment, which is now one of the lowest amongst all the OECD countries, $56 a day, Ross. And if there was ever a time for us as a country to come together to say we need to make sure everybody is at least okay in these very uncertain times, that is one of the key things we need to do is fix the adequacy of job seeker and youth allowance so that when unemployment hits you, you're not plunged into deep poverty and, in the face of these increasing rents.
As a total contrary idea to that, right, is the best form of welfare a job?
It's both, isn't it? What we want is to get a great, decent job, to be able to get your foot into the labour market, to get on the road with that. But if you lose your job or you face discrimination or you are not getting a look in with employers, and increasingly that's really hard in the digital environment. We know it's tough to be seen by an employer. You need some backup, and that's why we were historically proud of having Social Security system that got built, but we've allowed it over the last couple of decades to be the place you go to make savings, to cut away at it, to freeze it. And so here we are now with, the lowest unemployment payment amongst OECD countries.
OK, because also the very nature of an open economy like Australia is that sometimes people do become unemployed through no fault of their own. So the fact is, when they do become unemployed, the idea is to try and get them back into the workforce as quickly as you can, but to support that person while they're trying to re-educate or get themselves back into the workforce.
Well, of course, because we know you've got to be able to feed yourself, you've got to have a place to live, Ross. You've got to, these are the basic human needs. Remember, we're a very wealthy country overall. We're one of the wealthiest countries in the world. We can afford to provide an adequate social security system to protect people when you lose your job or for some reason you cannot be in paid work. Let's remember, there's a large number of people who are either dealing with chronic illness or some kind of other reason why they can't be in full-time paid work. And at the same time, to do everything we can to get to genuine full employment. I mean, that's one of the things for us right now. We've got this opportunity, 4.1% unemployment. We could go lower. Let's go lower than that. Let's make sure that we're really providing employment opportunities for everybody who wants
one. And one other trend is one group of traditionally disadvantaged people in our society is older people. When they finish work, they realise that really the amount of money they've got isn't enough to sustain themselves. They may end up on an age pension. But the real answer right now is a lot of those people are choosing to remain in the workforce for longer. For better or worse, they're choosing to stay there to keep on earning the income. And so, again, the trends in our society, the demographic trends in our society, is changing. There are more older workers in our workforce.
It really is. And, of course, because what we've seen happening with housing prices, people who are in the property market are doing extremely well, Ross. There's a huge growth in wealth amongst people who are in the market, and then you've got the people who were not in the housing market. And whatever age you are hurting because of that. Rents have gone up, and if you're a person who's older, and you haven't got wealth behind you, when you get to that point where you are trying to ease back from paid work, you can't afford to do it.
Yeah.
And so people are, of course, staying in the labour market. Now, we should celebrate that. We want to deal with ageism,
well, again,
don't
we? You want that older, experienced person. You want people to have the choice, really.
But many older people will say to me, I want to make sure that the young people of today too are okay. And that's, there's a really shared voice coming through now. That's what I'm hearing. People see this divide. They're not comfortable with it. And we've got to invest big now, I think, in making sure that people get secure place to live. That needs a big investment in social and affordable housing. There's a lot of talk about it, but we're not seeing the really big dollars that need to go in there. And, of course, that will be great for jobs and for the economy as well.
Cassandra Goldie, always good to chat to you, and many thanks for your time today.
Thanks, Ross.
The scary prospect for every company owner, manager or director is that a cyber attack is now a matter of when and not if. Indeed, future attacks might already have been built into your systems that, say, companies, governments or departments have already installed. And the evidence of this is the recent attack on Hezbollah by Israeli security forces, which turned apparently innocent pages into explosive devices. Now, that's an extreme example, I know, but it could be real in any business or government department right now. Well, Glenn Maiden is the Director of Threat Intelligence Operations at Fortinet's FortiGuard Labs, one of the largest threat intelligence organisations in the world, and I spoke with him a little earlier.
Yeah, it's very, very easy, Ross, to mount an attack these days. And because our systems are so interconnected, it only takes one minor little touch to potentially cause a whole bunch of damage. So if you think of when you turn the tap on in your kitchen in the morning or when you go out to fill up your car full of petrol to come into work, we couldn't go for very long without some of these essential services being shut down due to a cyber attack without experiencing quite significant ramifications.
So say, for example, I know that with AUKUS, say, for example, in the future submarines, that even now there is planning to have really every microchip sourced back to its base so that they catalogue every element of every part of what are going to be very complex machines. Is this the sort of thing that every company now needs to consider for its own protection in the future?
I think it's something that they should be thinking about. I know certainly my company, Fortinet, we trace, you know, the components all the way through to the assembly, to the manufacturing, all the way to when it gets put into a box and delivered to the customer. So, yeah, we want to make sure we've got that chain of custody all the way from the hardware, which could potentially be tampered with, as we saw in the Hezbollah example, through to the software, which is probably a bigger risk because that can be done without actually having to have physical proximity to some of these systems and devices.
OK, but is it potential that almost it's too late, that the problems are already inbuilt, awaiting sort of the unlocking by either hackers or other state-sponsored sort of, if you like, extremists? You don't quite know where the threat might come from in the future.
No, it's a great question, and I've been thinking about this idea of hybrid warfare and cyber-enabled attacks and cyber attacks for quite some time. And it's you're quite right. At the moment, we could have some very, very serious adversaries in our critical infrastructure systems. At the moment, they're probably just doing espionage. They're stealing some of our secrets, but that could very easily have that access that's pre-positioned pivot into an attack at a later date when the geopolitical tensions get to that point.
So was the CrowdStrike outage, even though that may have been a fault and an update fault, could have that been a very good example of the sort of disruption that could occur if you get a state-sponsored actor trying to be malicious inside any particular country's systems?
CrowdStrike was a little bit different because that was just a bug. It wasn't actually a cyber incident. But if you think back to the SolarWinds attack a couple of years ago, the Russian threat actors in that case got all the way into the US Department of Energy and a whole bunch of defence suppliers. So absolutely, that was a long attack where they spent months and months and months, if not years, to get into some of these suppliers who weren't even the target. The target was US defence and US government.
But the reality is there's going to be collateral damage. Collateral damage, yes, is the outage of systems that affect people. And given the fact that now our money, our finances is increasingly online, it's not actual physical. So this is the reality of the future if all of a sudden systems are shut down for any prolonged period.
Yeah, and that's what we saw with in the criminal space, not so much on the cyber threat actor space, but they realised a while back that they can make a lot of money not just by stealing our data and then selling that back to us or ransoming that back to us or even our competitors. But if they take out one of our banking systems or one of our port systems and have boats floating around on our coast for a couple of days, you know, that can be billions and billions of dollars and a big incentive for us to pay that ransom to get access to our systems again really quick.
One thing that sort of strikes me is that those people who are the threats, that their costs are relatively small as compared with their potential returns. So the incentive is there for these bad actors to continue to act and to continue to innovate. And as you get more artificial intelligence, of course, you're getting bigger data centres, more complex data centres. There's more incentive for them to be even better at their job.
It's one of the scary parts about a cyber attack. If you think of the rockets flying around the Middle East at the moment, a cyber attack is much cheaper, much easier. It's a lot easier to attribute to somebody else. And I don't have to be very close to you. I don't have to be within that sort of, you know, kilometre range. I can, if I was a threat actor, whether it's North Korea or Iran, and they wanted to attack us here in Australia, they could quite happily launch that attack from overseas, and it could be just as devastating.
OK, so then when it comes down to company directors or managers or whatever it is who are trying to sort of, if you like, have some form of control over this, the reality is there's very little control you might have unless you try and build the back end, the defences that you require. But you've got to be absolutely vigilant to understand that this is a genuine business risk.
You are quite right. And I think in some cases, prevention is the only cure. The good thing from my perspective, especially being in that sort of threat space, in the threat intelligence space, the threats are changing all the time. But what we've been doing in cybersecurity for 25, 30 years, a lot of the defensive type of strategies haven't change too much and don't need to. We still have to have role-based access. We still need to keep our systems up to date. We still need to have defence in depth. So I think if we focus on getting the things right that we know that we know that we can do, we're practiced, there's nothing new in there, we can make ourselves a lot more resilient to some of these ever-emerging and changing threat environments.
It is often said that war zones are the great test of defences and of attacking sort of, if you like, arms. Is it a case where Ukraine or what's taking place in the Middle East right now gives you a sense of the type of attacks that could come from places such as Russia or from Iran or yes, Hezbollah, wherever it might be? Are there actually now advances being created in the defences as a result of those wars?
Well, I think I watched the invasion of Ukraine very, very closely, and watching sort of some of the physical and the kinetic parts of that campaign, and then lining that up to some of the destructive wiper malware that was also sort of, you know, let loose into the Ukrainian environment as part of that invasion, there was a real correlation in terms of when there was activities as part of the military, they were absolutely in synchronisation with the cyber activities. It is an absolute, they say it's the fifth dimension of warfare now. It is well practised and well part of some of these malicious state campaigns now.
Glenn Maiden from FortiGuard Labs, part of Fortinet. Many thanks for your time.
Thank you, Ross.
And that's it for this week's program. Up next, all the latest news right here on Sky News. Business Weekend returns next Sunday. But of course, you can keep up to date with all the latest business news with our daily program, Business Now, 4:30 p.m. Eastern Time, and via our website, skynews.com.au. Thanks for your company. I'm Ross Greenwood. We'll see you next week.